Consider steady state, fully developed flow in a pipe where the flow is in the x direction. So because it's steady state, du dt equals zero. Because it's fully developed, du dx equals zero. And what that means is we have no local or convective acceleration. Therefore, Newton's second law simplifies to the sum of the forces equals zero instead of mass times acceleration. So let's look at a fluid element and do a force balance on it. And again, we're assuming steady state, fully developed flow. So we have our pressure force, P1 times pi r squared on this surface. On this surface, we have P1 minus delta P, or the change in pressure, times pi r squared. So those are our normal forces. We also have our tangential force, which is our shear stress. And this is tau times 2 pi r l. And one thing you need to be careful of are these areas, because this is a tangential force. The area that it is acting on is 2 pi RL, whereas the normal forces are acting on the cross-section area of the pipe. And so when we sum these forces, P1 pi R squared minus, and this is minus because it's in the negative x direction, P1 minus delta P pi R squared minus, and again it's minus because of the coordinate system, tau times 2 pi r l, this equals zero. So if we divide through by pi r squared and we simplify it, we end up with delta p minus 2 times tau times l over r equals zero. Or the delta P per length equals 2 times tau divided by R. Now let's look at the pipe wall. At the pipe wall, R equals D divided by 2, and our tau is our shear stress at the wall. So we can then say that delta P equals 4 times L times the shear stress at the wall divided by D. So here's a relationship between the shear stress at the wall and our pressure drop. Now we can go further, remembering that tau equals minus mu du dr. The reason it is negative, because tau is greater than zero when du dr is less than zero, which is the case as the velocity decreases from the center. So putting this together, we can write du dr equals negative delta p divided by 2 times mu times l all times r. End up with our u of r equals minus delta p over 4 times mu times l r squared plus C1. So in order to solve for that C1, we need a boundary condition. In other words, we need to relate U to some R. So one of the things that we could say is, what happens at R equals zero? Well, at R equals zero, it's a maximum, so du dr equals zero. But if we try and put that in our equation, it's not going to help us solve for C1. So instead, what we say is, at R equals D over 2, U equals 0. And that's because of the no slip condition. So let's put those boundary conditions in. So U equals 0 equals minus delta P over 4 times mu times L. And now our R squared is d squared over 4 plus c1. And this then allows us to solve for c1 as delta p d squared over 16 times mu times L. Next, we put that in our equation for u of r, and that equals minus delta p over 4 mu L times r squared plus delta p d squared over 16 times mu times L. So we're going to divide by delta p d squared over 16 mu L. And so if we do that, take a look here. If we divide this through, then we get u of r equals delta p d squared divided by 16 times mu times L, 1 minus 4 r squared over d squared. Or we can write this as delta p d squared over 16 mu L, 1 minus 2r over d squared. And when r equals 0, we get the center line velocity, v sub c, which is delta p d squared over 16 mu times L.